My mission is simple, to make you money. I'm here to level the playing field for all investors. There's always a bull market somewhere, and I promise to help you find it. Mad Money starts now.
Hey, I'm Cramer. Welcome to Mad Money. Welcome to Cramerica. Other people are my friends. I'm just trying to make some money. My job is not just to entertain you, but to educate and teach you. So call me at 1-800-743-CNBC or tweet me at Jim Cramer. Are we back in bad news is good news land? Or has the market come unglued from reality? And that's the big question after a day where we got a really ugly employment report. This morning's number, non-farm payrolls down 140,000 in December. Most economists were expecting an increase. Yet there was green all over the place. Dow ultimately edged up 57 points, S&P advanced 0.55%, and the Nasdaq gained an amazing 1.03%. Maybe the market saw this week this coming. How can we have job growth when COVID's running wild, causing a 500,000 layoffs in the leisure and hospitality sector alone? Unfortunately, we're doing such a poor job distributing the vaccines that you can't expect a rebound anytime soon. Which brings me back to the bad news is good news thesis. Every disappointing jobs number like this one makes it more likely we'll get another round of government stimulus checks to help cushion the blow. Still, let's not lose sight of the key takeaway. While this economy has some pockets of strength, things like home building, a host of commodities keep going higher. We've also got mass unemployment thanks to an increasingly deadly pandemic. That means the Federal Reserve needs to keep interest rates low to help spur hiring. When you combine the slower economy with a dovish Fed, you get a situation where stocks, yes, I know this term is kind of old hat to you now, but they're the only game in town versus bonds, most certainly. And that means you'll get some prolonged moves higher, like the incredible run in Tesla, which vaulted another 8% today to yet another new high, as one analyst after another concedes that the company's doing better than expected. And as the S&P 500 index funds are forced to buy the darn thing at ever higher prices, thanks to its inclusion in the index, Tesla keeps chugging higher. Plus, the seemingly unstoppable stock serves as an umbrella covering the whole electric vehicle cohort, and it seems like one of those stocks created every day. I can't blame anyone for trying to find the next Tesla here, although I'd rather stick with the original Tesla. A bird in the hand is worth two in the bush, unless, of course, the bird in the bush is a legitimate hydrogen fuel cell play like Plug Power. More on that later. Now, when the economy's downshifting, the hedge fund playbook says you need to buy the secular growth stocks that can hit their numbers even in a slowdown. I keep hearing hedge fund managers say it's time to dump growth and swap into value because the economy's accelerating. But I don't see that. I think they're wrong. If there's a growth stock that's doing well in an environment where we could be on the verge of a national light lockdown, for heaven's sake, I want to know about it because it's probably worth buying. Which brings me to the game plan for next week. We're doing a deep dive into the most important brokerage conference of the month. That's the J.P. Morgan Healthcare Confab. We went out there personally last year, obviously not this year because of the pandemic. We're going to have Lisa Gill. She's the host on our show tonight. You're going to hear about a lot of great growth stories that don't need a strong economy. That's what I like. Now, on Monday, I want to know what Bristol Myers has to say about the new drug pipeline they picked up when they acquired MyoKardia. A lot of people think they spent too much money on that. I don't know. I think it might be good. And then we hear from J&J, Moderna, and Regeneron. Will J&J's vaccine be ready sooner than expected? Can Moderna speed up manufacture of their already approved vaccine? Why aren't doctors prescribing Regeneron's COVID therapy, the one that saved the president? I hope we'll find out. The J.P. Morgan conference is the place where drug and biotech companies make very big announcements. If J&J's got some good news on the vaccine front, we're going to hear about it there. We may also get some insight from Emergent Biosystems, a contract manufacturer we've had on the show with a lot of vaccine exposure. We know they have business with J&J. You know what I would love to hear, but it may be too good to be true, that maybe they're sitting on a billion doses and we're just waiting on the thumbs up from the FDA. But who knows? Then there's the other huge conference next week. This is CES. That's the Tech Expo, formerly known as the Consumer Electronics Show. I'm most interested in a keynote from AMD, which is presenting on Tuesday morning, and Microsoft on Wednesday morning. What do I want to hear? With AMD, we want to hear about their PC and gaming business. Maybe they'll give us a little insight to the Xilinx acquisition if it gets to close. Microsoft, we actually want to know about everything. You know, I like both of them a great deal. Next up, KB Homes reports on Tuesday. And I've got to tell you, the home builders are a major pocket of strength in this economy because they're propped up by low interest rates and people fleeing the cities for the suburbs or the country because of the pandemic. KB Home is big in the parts of California that people are moving to. Let's see what they have to say. And then it's back to the J.P. Morgan Healthcare Conference, this time to hear Pfizer and CVS talk about many things, including, of course, the vaccine. I wouldn't be surprised if Pfizer tells us they can roll out even more doses than expected, and CVS says it's ready to administer them in all 10,000 stores as soon as the government gets its act together. AbbVie's presenting, too. We need to know if they're protected from the loss of exclusivity, which is now only 2 years from now, of Humira, which is their largest drug. I think that they are, but let's see what people say. On Wednesday, Walgreens speaks. They're going to give us a more complete picture on vaccine distribution. We also want to hear what Danaher has to say about its biopharma equipment division. Danaher is an incredible long-term performer, and now they've got a chance to tell us about this terrific biopharma asset that they got from General Electric. Thursday, President-elect Biden, will trace out his stimulus plans. Now, that's going to be a major market mover for certain, given how stocks keep bouncing around based on hints about the size of the stimulus. Biden wants to avoid a double-dip recession, and today he said that means throwing money at the economy until we beat the pandemic and things get back on track. Also on Thursday, we hear from the most important semiconductor company out there that we don't talk about, Taiwan Semi. You know, this is a $500 billion wafer maker that's indispensable to the entire industry. Taiwan Semi says things are still going strong. That can move the entire group. We need to know how the airlines are doing, given that they're arguably the weakest link in the economy. Delta always shoots straight. They're going to give us a status report when they announce their earnings. I know there's a constant thirst for more info about the cannabis industry among you. We hear from Afria on Thursday, too. Remember Erwin Simon used to be at Hain? Well, he runs that show, and I think he's going to tell a profitable story. I expect him to be very rosy about the industry's prospects now that the more weed-friendly Democrats have taken the Senate. Finally, earnings season officially kicks off on Friday with the major banks, and that's going to be J.P. Morgan and Wells Fargo. These are stocks that are coming off some incredible runs. Will those moves be backed up by good numbers? You know what? I don't really think so. But if the economy is about to improve like so many of the bulls think, and the vaccines are coming and Washington will pass more stimulus, then these banks could represent decent investments for the next few quarters, provided interest rates rise. The bottom line, with a new president taking office in less than 2 weeks, we may be more interested in what Biden says than in any individual company. Rest assured, though, when earnings season begins in earnest, it'll be profits we want to know about, not politics. I want to go to Tom in New York, please. Tom.
Jim, how are you tonight?
I am doing very well. How about you, Tom?
Doing great. Listen, I have a question. What market forces cause a stock like Veeva Systems to have a really good reaction to their earnings report? And then the next week or 3-4 weeks, they're going up and down, sideways, down 7-9%. What's happening there?
All right. Well, this is a really great question. I'm glad you asked it. Of course, we had Peter Gaster on his great quarter. What's happening is that people think that they're going to blow the quarter. There are a lot of shorts in there because at times for a trade, they say, well, you know what? The stock's moved up. It can't continue this 100 times earnings, which is what it sells for, wrap. And then it doesn't blow up. It does a good job. So they cover. That causes a temporary spike. And then it kind of and then what it really does is just kind of flit around. I call it flopping and chopping. Until the next quarter. That's the way Veeva trades. I've been following it for a long time. Let's go to David, my old home state of Pennsylvania. David.
Booyah, Jim. Go Birds.
Go. Where are they going?
Hopefully to the Super Bowl. I'm sure you, next year. I'm sure you've heard of this back merger, IPOC to Clover Health, CLOV. It made its mark on the FinTwit world. Shout out to the Sapphire and Atlas fam. And it just performed its change today while getting a $20 price target from Bank of America. Has partnerships with Walmart, and is the only Medicare stock not in the hundreds or even above 50 yet. With a market cap of $1.5 billion, we should be at least in the 30s. I got to know, are you bullish or bearish?
You know, I was bullish about it. Everybody, these things are so hard to follow. But, you know, it did have that very big spike in December. But you're absolutely right. I think it is very, very good. And why don't you let it season here? Because you know what happens is they go up big, and then they work their way down to a level that's a little more reasonable. And I don't think we're there yet, but we could be very, very close. And we know that the chairman and CEO is a much loved figure on CNBC. Josh in New York. Josh.
Hey, Jimbo. We're so happy to have you back this week. Hope you had a good holiday.
Yeah. I had to spend some time with the family. It's been a long time. And, you know, it's getting a little stir crazy, too. What's going on?
Yeah, I feel you. All right. So I'm calling about a healthcare company you've had on the show several times. and the stock has been down. Back in September, they did a voluntary recall on the asthma medication. And then in November, they reported decent earnings but had a tax ruling in Ireland. Now they just caught a downgraded RBC. Jim, what do I do with Perrigo?
Oh, man, the Perrigo's speaking next week at the J.P. Morgan conference. You know what? I would like to say that Mr. Kessler, I thought he told a good story when he was on and sells it like 10 times next year's earnings. But at the same time, if they're about to speak, why don't we listen to what they have to say? And that's a much more considered judgment than just saying, here's what I think they may say. Thank you for the balls up. President-elect Biden will be the real focus next week when he comes up and tells you about a stimulus package. But profits are going to be starting to be the major part of the discussion on Friday. Well, Mad Money, tonight, I've got the earnings exclusive with the CEO of Micron. Then the IPO lockups come, and I've got to tell you, one of them is in the TV business. I didn't even want to mention it. And it's going to be a deluge. And the J.P. Morgan Healthcare Conference is going virtual this year, but with more people than ever focused on the healthcare space, we got to get an early look, as I just mentioned, about the Perrigo caller and see what they have to say. So stay with Cramer.
Don't miss a second of Mad Money. Follow at Jim Cramer on Twitter. Have a question? Tweet Cramer. Hashtag Mad Tweets. Send Jim an email to madmoney@cnbc.com. Or give us a call at 1-800-743-CNBC. Miss something? Head to madmoney.cnbc.com. Don't miss a second of Mad Money. Follow at Jim Cramer on Twitter. Have a question? Tweet Cramer. Hashtag Mad Tweets. Send Jim an email to madmoney@cnbc.com. Or give us a call at 1-800-743-CNBC. Miss something? Head to madmoney.cnbc.com.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.